So hello and welcome to another episode of GDL-IL, GDL Israel. Today we're going to speak about Google APIs, how easy is it to work with them and consume them both from the client and the server. We have a few examples that show you the power of working with Google APIs with JavaScript, of course, on the client side. And then on the server side, I choose to show some simple examples in PHP, because it's the recent addition to Google App Engine. So I guess people will want to see how to leverage it. So today we don't have any slides, we just have some codes. And let me share with you my screen, so we'll be able to flip quickly between the browser and the text editor. So let's move this one. And let's see first how we're going to tackle it. So we'll start on the server side. And to start on the server side, basically you need to go and download the library that enable you or encapsulating for you all the rich functionality that you have in Google APIs. It's a one line, and as you can see here, you just need to copy this one with CURL and get it. Once you get it, actually, if you click on this link, it will download it for you immediately. You unzip it, of course, tar it, and then you have a quite nice set of examples that showing you the power of different APIs that you could leverage out of the vast, enormous richness of different APIs that Google allowing you to consume. Another important note is the console. So on the console, let's go here to the GDL example that I started. When you're just starting with the console, you basically need to create yourself auth2 client ID. And you need to do it because lots of Google services, and I guess if you will create with Google Cloud Endpoint a service for you, you'll want to make sure that it's authenticated. And the easiest way to do it is just to come here, to click on the OAuth2 button, give your product a name. In our case, it will be GDL. And probably we'll want to give here some sort of a logo, a nice one, and a page URL. All the projects, and then we're clicking yes. You could choose if it's going to be a web application or a service where basically you'll want from your application to make the calls, or an install application. So for native apps in Android and iOS, or on Windows, Linux, or Mac, you'll probably want to choose this option. In our option, let's stick with web application, but please remember that you could also get it as a service, and then basically you don't need any other information. If you're going with web application, one of the important things is that you need to enter your endpoint of your application. And in our case, just to make things real, let's keep with the localhost. And then you'll have the redirect, of course, that basically will get the confirmation after Google is authenticated your user or your call and giving you a token to continue with. In my case, you could see that quite quickly set it to be localhost and OAuth callback. And of course, you could edit those settings and add a few other redirects URL to other environments that you have. So in most of the cases, you'll probably want to put the QA environment, maybe the staging environment, and then hopefully on production, you won't use the same keys, you'll create a new one. After we created this, we're going with services. And for the services, you have here a huge richness of different services that you could active. Some of them are completely free, some of them are with just a bit of payments per usage, but it's all very detailed right here in the console. And you could see quite quickly how many you have active, how many you have inactive. And just to show you how you play with it, so let's say that I want to work with, I don't know, the calendar API. So I'll activate it, Of course, I need to confirm the term of service, and once I am accepting it, I have here now one active service that I could run on this specific service. Now, if I want to start and see what I can do with this service, there's a nice question mark here, and if I'll click on try it out, immediately I'm being redirected, and I can start and see what this API is exposing to me. So this is part basically of the discovery mechanism that we have. And if you remember during my talk in last I/O, we spoke about cloud endpoint and how you could leverage this system and creating your own API and enjoying this discovery mechanism to make your work more productive. So after we do all this, basically we have a few other things that we could run with. Here you have a very nice page that letting you check which services you authorize, and once you're working with development, you might want to revoke access to some of the services so you could test again and again the authentication phase and make sure that you're doing the right things. If you want to play with a certain API, one great way to work with the API on the web without coding even one line is just to go to developers.google.com and go here on the API Explorer. And in our case, I choose the YouTube data API because this is the example that I prepared. And here you could see that, let's say that I want to get from YouTube the ID and the snippet per video. Then I want the max results to be, I don't know, 9. And the query that I'll put, it could be ski, it could be snowboard. And once I'm executing it, I'm getting here the response. I could take basically this and just play in other environment on it. But here you could see that I got 200, so everything is cool. And here I'm getting a nice JSON object that basically describing all the result sets. And you could see that I'm getting the videos, I'm getting the thumbnails to the videos, the ID, everything that I basically requested. Now, if we looked how this example looked on PHP, on PHP it will be quite similar in a lot of sense. So we'll come here and might be a bit crowded, but I hope that you could see here. Basically, we have a simple page that letting us query YouTube API. We want to get from the user a search term, and then probably to limit the result. And that's it, and a button for the search action. What I'm fetching here is two files that actually exposing and encapsulating YouTube service. So it's first the Google client, so just I'll have all the basic functionality, and then the YouTube itself. And once I'm doing that, I have here, of course, the developer key, and now I'm just calling the constructor of Google client and working with it. So I'm setting the developer key, and I'm calling with this client to YouTube service. After I do this, exactly like I showed you in the Explorer API, I'm basically calling YouTube search list. And you could see here in the Explorer API that it's exactly same endpoint. So this one is exactly like this one. And again, very similar to what we did in the example on the API Explorer, I'm going and I'm concentrating on the ID and the snippet. I want to pass the query. And of course the max result, so this is my payload. And now all I'm doing is going on this nice loop and making sure that the result set, which is basically separated to three buckets. One is the videos, then the channels, and then the playlist will bring back, and in my body, I will just make sure that I'm constructing those lists. So I'm using the UL and the LY tags just to construct it, and here very simple, I just embedded it here and that's it. Let's look how it's working on my local environment. So let's close now the dev tool, we look at them later. So if I'm searching for, I don't know, and I'm limiting it to 10 results, when I'm clicking search, basically it's going to YouTube, returning, and as you can see here, basically I just added the image as well. So unlike the previous example, we're getting a more holistic search results, if you will. So it's a bit more informative. And exactly like you saw before that, here on the API Explorer, I'm just fetching the elements from the result sets and just presenting them on the page itself. Now, as you all know, we have a bunch of client libraries that actually letting you leverage Google APIs. On the web, you might use the JavaScript library, and I'll show in a minute an example how easy and smooth it is to work with. But if you're working with JavaScript on the server side, we have a nice library for Node.js, so please feel free to check it out. By the way, all the links are here. So if you'll go to pictures-app.appspot.com, you'll be able to look at the slides that are from the previous I/O talk, but also on slide 25, as you can see here, all the links to all the different libraries and languages that you could leverage. So for the ones that are building native clients, both for iOS and Android, we have a nice libraries. And of course, on the server side, you have a bunch of languages, and actually, we have even for .NET and GWT and many others. So let's close that and see how we could run on authentication. So in this specific example, let's first look at the code and then we look at the live example. I want to authenticate myself and get some information from G+. In our case, probably it will be the image and the email, but as you can imagine, you could run and do a lot of more things once you get the token, the handle of your user. This is the very short example, and as always in JavaScript, let's jump to the end. And first and foremost, we're calling Google client library, the JavaScript client library, and we're giving it here a callback. So on the onload, we'll handle basically the callback. And see what we're doing. So we're setting, of course, the client ID and some boilerplate data like the API key and the scope. And then when we're coming here to the handle, the client load, we're setting those API keys, and we just want to call immediately the check authentication. So we did it with set timeout. After we're doing it, we're just going to GAPI, Google API, and this endpoint on the authentication, we want to authorize. The authorize will be done with the client ID, the scope, and of course we want to do it immediately. And then we're giving it another callback to just handle the result set that we're getting back. In our case, it's this one, and when we're getting the authentication, we want to do several things. So first, if everything is okay and we don't have any error, let's just go here and hide the authorize button so the user won't be confused. And in a real world case, you might want at this stage to make sure that you're confirming and you're showing the user that he or she are logged in. It might be through a nice image of themselves or any other nice bold way to show that they are now logged in and authenticated. And now we're making the API call. Of course, on the opposite direction, we do want to make sure that the button is visible, so like you're seeing here, so people could authorize themselves and log in or sign into our app. Once we are handling the authentication, we want basically to make the API call. We're going to G+ API, we're controlling the version, so in our case here it will be V1. And basically what I want to fetch from people is just me. And I'm taking the image of myself and just putting it on the page itself. Now let's work on the live example and see how it does. So as you can see here, I'm being authenticated, so it's immediately popping up the request for permission dialog. In this case, you could see that I use the Chrome extension book examples just because I have it handy, and hopefully in the near future you'll be able to see some live relevant examples to Chrome extensions. But I'm allowing access, and then basically I've been redirected again to this page, and as you can see, I have now my photo and my title here. So this is one example that showing you the power of it. And now Let's see another simple example that's showing you. So I have here another page, which is basically the hello world or the sample that you're getting with Google API PHP client examples. And here basically we'll do exactly the same, but instead of JavaScript, we'll just leverage PHP. So I'm going to the directory of the example user info. And after I log out before the session, of course, I want now to authenticate myself. So again, I'll get this nice authorization dialogue. And after I'm doing it, and as you can see here, it was in Hebrew, I'm getting again, in this case, my email and photo. How the code looks like, let's jump real quick. And let's remove this one for a second. Yeah. So here, yeah. So again, I'm calling the Google Auth 2 service. And after we setting the Google client and giving it a bunch of IDs, that by the way, the client ID, the developer key, and everything else could be found here on your API access tab. So if you click on it, basically all the relevant information that you need to copy paste, like the client ID, the client secret, and the API key are all here. So just remember API's console, and this is the location. So once you're doing that, basically we're calling the auth service with our client, and we are passing the code, and we want to fetch the token. The token is something that we'll carry with us, so we'll be able to confirm again and again if we need to the service itself. And since in this case, or at the beginning, if we're getting the token here, then we just need to go do the redirect and we're all good. If not, we want to set the token, make sure that if the user clicking on logout, we're of course revoking the token. And here, we're just calling the client and want to fetch the token. So after we're getting it, and this is returning us true because we have the token in the client, we're basically going to the auth service, and with the user info object, we want to get the information. And as you saw in my case, it was in the PHP case, it was the email and the picture, the profile picture. And what we did with it is just we put it on the page so we'll be able to see it. Here, last but not least, we of course want to save in our session token or any other place that you find convenient and safe for your app. The token itself, so you'll be able to leverage it and use it later on in your app. And this is all we have here. So a bit of HTML that we have later on is just to make sure that we have those two cases of connect or logged in and then logged out. So this, I guess, was a very short introduction to Google APIs. Next week or in the near future, I'll try to show you how you could leverage those types of API that you're building for your services. And that's with Google Cloud Endpoint, that basically taking those APIs that we're using internally and just expose them to developer. So if you want to leverage Google App Engine and create a powerful, scalable API on top of it, you might want to use Google Cloud Endpoint, and then you benefiting and getting for free all the great capabilities of the discovery mechanism, the API Explorer, and all the richness of libraries that are already for you. We'll speak about it hopefully next week, and if not, in the near future. And now it's a great time for questions. If someone that joined us have, please feel free. Okay, so later on, if someone have any questions, just feel free to reach me on plus.google.com/plusgreenido, one word. And until next week, have a great time and bye-bye.